Little Brown Audio presents Too Many Cooks, a Prudence Bulstrode mystery. Book 3, written by Rosemary Shrager and read by Rachel Atkins. To Freddie, my grandson. Chapter 1. Devil's Corner was not the official name for this particular bend in the clifftop road, but now that her camper van was parked precariously upon its verge, dangerously close to the crumbled sandstone edge and the perilous drop to the sea below, Prudence Bulstrode decided that it was rather apt. "Devil's food cake I can cope with," she said to her granddaughter Suki, who was currently absorbed in her iPhone, watching instructional videos on how to change a flat tyre. "But the Devil's Corner might be the end of us, dear. Now, help me with this jack, won't you? I'm afraid at this age I can't do it alone." The afternoon was growing old, but the journey from Prudence's sleepy home village to the uttermost end of the earth, or Cornwall, as it was more commonly called, was a long one. And owing to a 3-hour traffic jam around Stonehenge, where at least the stranded drivers might gaze out upon the majesty of a few old stones, it had taken longer still. Now, with the light paling and the sun beginning its descent toward the sea, Prudence wondered if they were going to have to spend the night right here. It wasn't that she hadn't done her share of wild camping and foraging in her life. Prudence's Meals for Nothing had been a big hit in the latter stages of her career, and featured such startling recipes as nettle and bilberry tart tatin and rabbit and seaweed stew. But the scrubby roadside of Devil's Corner did not immediately offer many opportunities to dig up delicacies from the natural world. There was, Prudence saw, a stand of fat hen, which did perfectly well in place of spinach, and she'd seen flowering yarrow in a hedgerow 500 yards back. But aside from this, there was just scrub grass and an occasional Coke can, no doubt thrown out of a passing car window. Hardly the basis of a feast, even for the most adept of cooks. "I've got a Twix, Grandma," said Suki, ferreting in her pocket. "And some gum." Prudence was on her hands and knees, contemplating how on earth you utilised a jack on a camper van. The thing seemed to be made for a mini. She wondered why she'd bought it. "I'm quite good for gum, thank you, Suki," she said cheerily. Suki, 18 years old, was finally looking more like a professional kitchen assistant. Her hair was still dyed black, but she had finally forgone the pale makeup which made her seem like a ghost. But she was still alarmingly naive. "Gum won't get us out of this, but good old elbow grease might."
"Gum might get us out of this, Grandma. There's a TikTok here showing you how to patch a punctured tyre with Wrigley's Extra. He's doing it on a bike, but I imagine the principle's the same."
Prudence had stopped listening at the word TikTok. But when Suki repeated the advice, she just wryly shook her head and looked around. She could at least take in the beauty of their surroundings. This, she reasoned, was good for the soul. Even if ferreting around in the dirt with grease under your fingernails and blisters from using the wrench wasn't. It had been some decades since she last came along this road. Behind them, the fishing port of Penzance clung to the coastline, and in front of her, only the pale blue of the summer sea. The cliffs here might have been perilous, but there was splendour in them as well. Beneath them stretched out all the manifold hidden beaches and coves of Cornwall. Only 8 miles separated them from Land's End, the furthest a soul could voyage in mainland Britain. For half a century she'd carried this particular corner of the world in her soul. Breathing in the salt air was like breathing in a bit of her history. One day, when she finally settled down to write her memoirs, she had long ago decided to call it The Prue Stew, Stories from My Life. Her years in this corner of the country would feature heavily and showcase recipes like stargazy pie, heather cake, and of course, her own inimitable take on the traditional pasty.
Grandma, I think we... Yes, I know what I'm doing, said Prudence, whose cheer was finally giving way to exasperation. She had just smeared grease across her aquamarine glasses. They wouldn't be so glitzy ever again. No, Grandma, I think there's... This time, Prudence looked up, meaning to tell Suki in no uncertain terms that she did not want any TikTok tips or advice from the nameless multitudes of Suki's precious internet. What she wanted was for Suki to get down on her knees and engage with the problem in front of them. She was about to open her lips and say as much when she saw Suki pointing further along the coast road. Her eyes flashed in the same direction. Only partially obscured by the greasy smears on her glasses, Prudence finally saw what Suki had clocked some moments before. A second camper van was approaching along the coastal road. Dipping in and out of sight as it followed every bend, soon it was coming in a cloud of dust around the Devil's Corner, where it promptly stopped, disgorging two girls of about Suki's age, with Suki's taste in dark clothing, dark makeup, and even darker expressions. In a flash, Prudence was back on her feet, wringing her hands on one of the camper van's dishcloths, then polishing her glasses on her sleeve. By the time a third girl, the driver, had stepped out of the new camper van, she considered herself at least reasonably presentable. "It's you, isn't it?" the girl said in a voice as shrill as one of Prudence's old PR representatives every time she'd got Prudence the coveted slot on Saturday Kitchen. "I'd know that face anywhere." Prudence looked around. She suspected the reason the girls recognised her was more to do with the fact that her camper van, iconic in its vivid peach and cyan paints, bore the legend Prudence Bulstrode's Travelling Kitchen in florid red letters. Even the number plate, Prue Boo 1, had a kind of fame of its own. Whatever the reason, Prudence was quite certain that girls of this generation had never watched any of her old television shows, nor browsed for her books in the libraries and bookshops, where she still went to do readings and offer all manner of advice. "Girls, you'll catch us at a most unfortunate moment, but you might be our angels come to earth. Now, do any of you know how to change a flat tire?" The faces of two of the girls flashed immediately to their own phones. A symphony of beeps and whirs accompanied their frenzied attempts to find whatever instructional videos Suki had already unearthed. It was the third girl, evidently the brains of the bunch, who shook her head wearily and declared, "I've got a better idea than that, Mrs. Bulstrode. We'll take you there ourselves." Prudence and Suki shared a look. "Well," the girl went on, "it's only fair. You've come all this way to teach us cooking. We can hardly leave you standing on the side of the road like lemons, can we? Hop on up, Mrs. Bulstrode. We can ask Ronnie Green up at the school to come back and change the tyre. Ronnie's an absolute doll. He's been handyman for 20 years. There isn't a thing he doesn't know about that school or this coast. Well, what do you say?" The girl grinned. "You'll want to lock her up, Mrs. Bulstrode." She looked up at the sky. "There's a storm coming on. We'll have to ask Ronnie to jump to it, or your camper be blown clean over the cliff." The thought of this prompted Prudence to unload as many of her supplies as she could into the second camper van, which took some considerable time. By the time they hit the road again, sailing down the cliff road to the cove at the very bottom, darkness was curdling. But even this brought back memories for Prudence. In Prudence's day, every journey along these old country roads had been undertaken by a rickety old bus. The thought of girls as young as Suki owning cars, let alone camper vans, was quite unthinkable. But as Suki insisted on telling her just about every other sentence, time kept on turning. She was lost in thoughts like these when, all at once, they rounded the bend. And there, nestled in the cove beneath them, sat St Marianne's School for Girls. Prudence was not often given to waves of nostalgia, but one crashed over her now. From on high, she could see the whole school, the west wing where the dormitories used to be. The hall and gymnasium, the outdoor blocks where girls did mathematics and science, as well as sewing and religion quite often, when they had to make their own samplers in the same lesson. There were the greenhouses, there the hockey pitch, there the kitchen garden, and the very same building in which Prudence had taken her first ever domestic science lessons with dear old Mrs. Jubber, and, for the first time, fallen in love with cookery. "Well, girls," she said, and tried to pretend that tears weren't misting her eyes, "I have to say I didn't think I'd ever be back here. You won't understand the gravity of this, not yet, but it's been nearly 50 whole years." "Oh, yes," the driver chirruped. She had introduced herself as Sophie and had a double-barreled surname with far too many syllables to safely pronounce. "We know all about it, Mrs. Bulstrode. They've been talking about you coming ever since it was announced last Christmas. Your face has been in every newsletter. They've got a big picture of you up in the reception hall. A cardboard cutout, no less. Life-size. They're very proud of you here, Mrs. Bulstrode. And, well, when they invited sixth formers to come back for a couple of weeks, extra lessons over the summer break, a crash course from the world-famous television chef, well, we could hardly turn our noses up, could we? None of us can make more than a sandwich, Mrs. Bulstrode, and Hetty here can't even do that." One of the other girls, evidently named Hetty, looked up from her phone and shrugged. "I just don't like bread," she remarked, "so I leave it out." Up ahead, the school was coming into clearer focus. Prudence could make out the groundskeeper's little house, the little orchard where the girls used to pick apples and plums, the corner of the playground, where she and her old friends used to gather and gossip. Yes, she'd been quite unable to resist when the invitation landed. 2 weeks to run a crash course in cookery for girls from her alma mater, preparing them to go off into the world and fend for themselves. Now that was the kind of commission Prudence's retirement was made for. "Look, Suki," said Prudence, and took her granddaughter's hand. "It's going to be a true trip down memory lane." Later, Prudence would look back and wonder at the simplicity of that statement. Later, after the body had been found, she would wonder if all of her golden days here had been a lie. But all of that was to come. For now, as they finally reached the boarding school and swung into the car park, Prudence was filled with all the wonderful feelings of a childhood revisited. There was a little time yet before murder reared its ugly head and changed everything. Mrs. Chastity Carruthers, 45 years old for the fourth time, and wearing the most garish of all the garish lipsticks found on the counter at Barker's department store in Penzance, had been impatiently hopping about the school reception hall for some time when she saw the camper van approaching through the windows. At first, her heart sank, for this certainly wasn't the camper van she'd seen in the glossy pages of Country Living, nor the article in Marks and Spencer magazine, which had first prompted her to invite dear old Mrs. Bulstrode back to the school. But then the doors opened up, and out stepped the very same lady whose cardboard cutout was standing at her side, cardboard egg whisk in hand. "You look even better in the flesh, Mrs. Bulstrode," she said to the cutout. Then she rushed forward to open the school doors. Mrs. Carruthers, the doyenne, she preferred the word to headmistress, which made her seem so matronly, of St Marianne's, had been rehearsing her welcome speech for some hours, slaving over it during a long, lonely night in the staff room. But the moment she opened the doors, the rain started coursing down from the hills, robbing her of every breath. Consequently, it wasn't until Prudence Bulstrode, her kitchen assistant, and three of the most disreputable girls attending the summer school had charged through the doors that she found the wherewithal to speak. Even then, her carefully planned speech seemed to vanish.
"Girls," she shrieked, "look at the state of you."
She was referring to the copious amounts of black makeup, which were now cutting rivulets down the faces of her students. But suddenly she stopped. clapped a hand to her mouth, and started gabbling an apology to Prudence instead.
"Oh, Mrs. Bulstrode, please don't think I meant you. You, Mrs. Bulstrode, look just divine."
She shot a look like daggers at the girls.
"It's this rain. It's made a mess of everything, but we'll have you dried out in a second. We can light the fire in the staff room, should you wish, though we've radiators as well, of course, and have done for many long years. And we'll get you out of those dirty clothes and..."
Prudence had just about finished polishing her glasses again when she felt Mrs. Carruthers grappling with her arm.
"I'm afraid we got caught on the headland. My camper van caught one of the potholes up there and burst its tyre, so we're a little behind the times."
"Behind the times?
No, Mrs. Bulstrode, never! You mustn't listen to what they say on these newfangled cookery shows. You're classical, you're refined, you're stately and traditional, and that's precisely what these girls need."
Prudence saw the look she was giving the students again. She'd been on the receiving end of one or two looks like those back in her own school days, and decided to throw the girls one of her own looks, this one filled with commiseration and understanding.
"I'll have Ronnie get your camper van back to base, Mrs. Bulstrode. We simply must have the Prue-mobile here for when the classes begin. There's a local photographer very keen to document the whole thing, for posterity's sake, you understand, and she'll be more keen than ever to have that camper in shot. Just think of the headlines. Local wonder returns to the stage. We're proud as punch to have you, Mrs. Bulstrode. Proud as punch."
Prudence had three times tried to get a word in, but Mrs. Carruthers evidently had no intent on letting her. Suddenly she was barking orders at the girls.
"Find Ronnie Green and find him this instant,"
and steering Prudence along the hallway. Prudence, who was rather used to excitable PR assistants whisking her along, but was yet to meet a headmistress quite as excitable, threw the girls another consolatory look as she departed. Suki, beached somewhere between them, seemed to think momentarily about following the girls, then trotted after her grandmother instead.
"Of course Ronnie's got an awful lot on this summer," Mrs. Carruthers was saying as they ventured from the reception hall deeper into the school's achingly familiar warren of corridors.
As they went, the rush of old feelings was almost overpowering to Prudence. It wasn't that the school hadn't changed since her day. Modernisation was the name of the game for schools as suddenly moneyed as this. Rather, it was that the feel of the place had somehow been retained. The footsteps echoed in the very same way. Somehow the smell of beeswax and vinegar polish rolling out of the performance hall was the same, redolent of those heady summers in the 1970s, when Prue and her friends had staged shows here. The way the light fell into the corridor outside the school office sparkled just as it had in 1974. The noise of the rain drumming on the plate glass windows.
"Oh, yes, lots," Mrs. Carruthers went on, quite oblivious to the way Prudence was daydreaming. "I'm afraid it's fallen to dear Ronnie to organise the contractors. You'll soon see, Mrs. Bulstrode, that time marches on here at St. Marianne's. Thanks to a very generous local investment, we've raised the funds to erect a state-of-the-art gymnastics facility. So I'm afraid it's goodbye to the hockey pitches and hello to the St. Marianne's Olympic Arena."
Prudence wasn't quite sure why St. Marianne's girls needed a state-of-the-art gymnastics facility at all. What gymnast needed more than a few bars and a pummel horse? But she wasn't sad to hear that the hockey pitch was to be no more. She'd been three times passed over as hockey captain in her time here, and yes, she knew it was pathetic. It had rankled ever since. At once Mrs. Carruthers stopped dead and turned on her heel. Prudence, whose daydreaming stopped just as suddenly, realised they were standing outside the site of the school staff room. Several times she'd been compelled to stand here, awaiting the emergence of whichever teacher was about to admonish her and her friends for some minor infraction. She glanced sideways at Suki. Yes, she thought, it was better not to share memories like this with Suki.
Prudence's granddaughter had only just found the road marked straight and narrow herself.
I completely forgot to tell you. You and I, Mrs. Bulstrode, have a very special connection.
Oh, yes? Asked Prudence, whose fans often said something along a similar line.
Indeed we do, Mrs. Bulstrode. I'm proud to announce that I was born on the very same day you were awarded this.
And Mrs. Carruthers stepped aside to reveal a single certificate, now browned around the edges, yellowed with age, mounted behind the perspex glass of a wall-hanging display. Prudence had to creep a little closer to see exactly what it said. Prudence Bulstrode, Form 13A, has been awarded the St Marianne's Prize for Home Economics, 12th of June 1976. Presented by Miss Agatha Jubber, Domestic Sciences.
Oh, said Prudence, and felt another rush of fond memories. But this hasn't been up on the wall all these years, surely. Oh, no, Mrs. Bulstrode. It's been in the school archive, looked after by our erstwhile librarian. I chanced across it some time ago, and I've been hoarding it ever since. You see, Mrs. Bulstrode, I rather feel as if we both began in the very same moment. Our stories are as one. Here you were, trotting up to stage to meet this Miss...
Mrs. Carruthers had to squint at the certificate to make sure she had the name right.
Jubber, taking what I like to think is your very first step towards being the nation's sweetheart, the shining light of the cookery world. And there was I, my head just crowning, my little face appearing between my mother's.
I see, said Prudence tactfully, before Mrs. Carruthers was able to continue that particular description.
Well, I have to say it is rather remarkable.
What was truly remarkable was that Suki was not already corpsing with laughter.
And I remember that day very well. Miss Jubber, well, that really is where it started for me. I have Miss Jubber and this school to thank for all of it. Without Miss Jubber, I don't think I'd have fallen in love with food at all. Somehow, she just made it so alive. When we were in that classroom, it was hard to put it into words. That magical feeling of finding your vocation, of falling headlong into it and realising, suddenly, that your entire life was being mapped out. I shall enjoy cooking in the domestic science block again. It isn't quite like you used to know it, said Mrs. Carruthers, wagging her finger. We're a little more state-of-the-art than we were. All the ovens are voice-activated now, of course, and the smart fridges can tell you exactly when your eggs are on the turn.
Prudence thought, so could I, by simply dropping them in a bowl of cool water, but she managed not to breathe a word.
Well, shall we get going, then? Prudence ventured. Dinner with the staff tonight, isn't it? I made sure we transferred as many of our packs from my camper van as we could. We didn't quite gather everything up, but there's more than enough to get started.
By instinct, Prudence rolled her sleeves up and wrung her hands together, as if in keen anticipation.
Any requests, Mrs. Carruthers? I'm quite able to make a menu up on the spot. In fact, I rather think of it as my party piece. And I was thinking, well, the school kitchens here used to serve the most dreadful beef and dumplings. For dessert, treacle sponge. I had it in mind, Mrs. Carruthers, that I might jazz up the old menu, show you all what beef and dumplings can really be like.
Mrs. Carruthers' face had suddenly contorted.
Oh, but Mrs. Bulstrode, don't you think of it? You cook for us? Well, I should be delighted, of course, to have any meal cooked by a lady of your pedigree. But you're our star. You're our guest of honour. You've come back to this school to give back to our students what we once gave to you. There'll be plenty of cookery going on this week, but tonight you're to be cooked for.
Prudence screwed up her eyes.
Mrs. Carruthers, I wasn't aware that you wanted to rustle something up, but really it's no problem to me if...
Me?
Mrs. Carruthers squawked, then threw her head back in such laughter that Mrs. Finch, Prudence's old drama teacher, would have summarily ejected her from the classroom for overacting.
Mrs. Bulstrode, unless you want jammy toast, I shan't be cooking for you tonight. No, we have something much better in store. We're to take you out on the town. We have a wonderful evening planned to welcome you back. A trip to the most hip-happening place, from here to Tintagel Castle.
She inclined her head as if to share in some confidence.
The bluff, Mrs. Bulstrode. It's the pride of Penzance. 2 Michelin stars and just waiting on a third. You must have heard of it. The chef there... Didn't you do a show with him once?
Prudence didn't have to dredge her memory banks particularly deeply to summon up this oddity. The bluff had sat on a lonely corner of coastland west of Penzance for half a generation, but only recently had it achieved the stardom over which Mrs. Carruthers was salivating. That was down to the efforts of a young chef named Benji, B-E-N-J-I, though Prudence was quite certain his mother hadn't christened him with that particular spelling, Huntington Lagan, one of the rising stars who'd got his start in cookery by posting endless videos of himself online, videos in which he sought to tutor others in skills he'd scarcely seemed to master himself. He and Prudence had been partnered together for a celebrity challenge one year, in honour of the BBC's Comic Relief Charity appeal. It was the kind of thing Prudence's old agent used to sign her up for without hesitation, because, of course, it was just perfect for the public profile, darling. And that was how Prudence Bulstrode had ended up as one of the 8 competitors in Chefs Go Ape, tasked with cooking a 3-course dinner for a troop of mountain gorillas in the windy, impenetrable national park in deepest, darkest Uganda. Through gritted teeth and with a perfectly painted-on smile, Prudence said, "It sounds fantastic. I can't wait to see how Benji's getting on. He's certainly grown his brand," that terrible saying he used to parrot every other sentence since we worked together.
"Yes, and let's hope he isn't serving us up grubs fit for a gorilla," grinned Mrs. Carruthers.
Then her face suddenly darkening, she turned to Suki and said,
"You can sort out Mrs. Bulstrode's supplies while we're gone, dear. Make sure everything's shipshape for her return."
Suki had her face buried in her iPhone, no doubt looking up the indignity that was Chefs Go Ape. So there was a second silence before she looked up, bemused. By then, Prudence had already weighed in.
"Suki is very much part of the team, Mrs. Carruthers. Where I go, Suki goes. This girl's learning so fast that someday soon she won't need me at all. But still learning," said Mrs. Carruthers, her heels clicking as she marched on. "Mrs. Bulstrode, this is a night for the adults. Some adult companionship and conversation and, well, our table's already booked."
"It's all right, Grandma," said Suki quietly. "I'm not sure I'm in the mood for..."
And she squinted at the menu on her phone, as if trying to decipher hieroglyphics.
"Deconstructed Cornish lobster Wellington, sequestered in a saffron and parmesan velouté, or..."
This next was even more difficult to get her mouth around.
"Peruvian ceviche amidst clusters of sea kale and salsified gel."
Suki looked up, puzzled.
"Grandma? Why does it say aggravated shrimp?"
Prudence lowered her voice.
"Because chefs like Benji can't just serve scampi and chips, my dear."
"I don't mind giving this one a miss, Grandma. I can take the packs up to our rooms. And I did promise I'd call Mum when we got here."
Prudence nodded. Of course, what Suki didn't know was that Prudence had observed her messaging a boy named Doogie.
What was wrong with the good old names? Where were the Matthews and Thomases anymore? Every time they stopped on the long road west.
No doubt what Suki actually intended to do was dash off a quick text to her mother, then spend the rest of the evening sending little hearts and pictures back and forth with this boy she'd met. Well, you were only young once, a fact that Prudence was being starkly reminded of now that she walked through her old school halls. And perhaps the evening would flash by more swiftly if she didn't have to keep an eye on her granddaughter as well. Then, tomorrow morning, they could get on with the proper business for which they'd been hired. Prudence Bulstrode, passing on all the knowledge she'd acquired in a long, storied career to the next generation of young cooks. There was almost something poetic about it. "Save me some tea and toast, Suki," Prudence whispered, as she and Mrs. Carruthers hurried away. "I have a feeling I'll need something to settle my stomach after our visit to the bluff." Coastal rain is the most dramatic kind of rain. It churns up the ocean, merges sea and sky, turns the world to a shifting, rippling curtain of grey. So it was as Mrs. Carruthers' private driver chauffeured both the headmistress and Prudence along the winding clifftop road, until some distance further west, they reached the little fishing port of Castalloch Cove. The village itself had grown since Prudence used to come this way. She and the girls from St Marianne's out on their bicycles on a lazy Sunday afternoon, off perhaps to meet one of the boys from St Cuthbert's on the other side of the cove. Prudence herself hadn't had much time for those boys, well, not many of them, but among her friends there had been girls with an insatiable appetite, not necessarily for the boys, but certainly for the thrill that came with breaking a sacred school rule. A few more houses had been built, and the village post office had been joined by a little cafe and delicatessen, but compared to the sprawl of London, progress here was practically mute. That was why the bluff, sitting on the headland above the town, up a long sweeping track, with only the restaurant as its destination, stood out so starkly. It had been a local watering hole in Prudence's day, a pub that served perfect pasties and fish and chips, and, on a Sunday, whole roast pollock and plaice. Back then, the bluff had taken a progressive view with underage drinkers, and Prudence was quite sure she'd had her first illicit tipple up here, a cider lemonade which would have made her feel quite giddy if it hadn't been for the crispy whitebait at the bar. Now, however, everything had changed. As the car reached the top of the headland, Prudence saw that only the shell of the old bluff remained. Instead of the old fisherman's retreat, there now stood a gleaming palace of white stone and plate glass. Pale mauve light spilled out of the front windows, with a constellation of miniature stars gleaming around the welcoming door. Taken in its craggy, windswept surroundings, and especially with the rain still lancing down, it looked to Prudence like the bastard offspring of a novel by Daphne du Maurier and a particularly indulgent episode of Grand Designs. At her side, Mrs. Carruthers seemed to be thrilling. "It isn't often you get to eat at a Michelin-starred restaurant, Mrs. Bulstrode, no? This'll be a true treat for us both." It was a short dash through the rain's rippling curtain to the restaurant doors. Then Prudence was standing in the bluff, being met by a maitre d', who looked as if she might have been cast in one of those horrendous reality shows Suki insisted on watching, and being led to the heart of the restaurant, where a table was already bustling with diners calling Prue's name. "Mrs. Bulstrode," Mrs. Carruthers began, settling into her seat at the head of the table. "Might I introduce our party? First and perhaps foremost, St. Marianne's loyal governor, Mr. Bernard Hogg." A porcine man with the bristles of a 19th century ship's captain stood up, snapped his braces tight, and grasped Prudence's hand.
"You may call me Bernie," he snorted, evidently delighted to make her acquaintance. "Bernie Hogg of Hogg's Tackle. We're the third biggest fishing goods firm between here and Plymouth. We don't hold a candle to Franks and Scots, of course, but we get along just fine. My daughter was a student at St Marianne's. A finer school you won't find. I'm proud as punch. And he punched Prudence playfully on the shoulder. To have stuck around as governor.
And prouder still to have you here, Prudence, added Mrs Carruthers.
Well, precisely, Bernie declared.
On Bernie's right-hand side was a face Prudence recognised in an instant.
Poppy? She ventured. Are my eyes deceiving me? Poppy, or is that... It's me, Prue, announced the woman as she flurried from her seat, throwing her arms around Prue and dangling there in a quite ungainly manner. My goodness, how long has it been? 30 years? 40?
The woman named Poppy gave a crumpled kind of look.
Gosh, it's hard to believe we got so old, Prue, but... Poppy, Prue ventured, still staggered at her presence. What on earth are you doing here? Well, it's right where I belong, of course.
Poppy gave a lopsided smile. Her blue eyes sparkled. At more than 60 years old, and despite the silvery hair that now flowed around her shoulders, she had retained something of the cherubic about her appearance. But Poppy Balloon always did have something youthful and magnetic about her, even back when she and Prudence used to prowl the halls of St. Marianne's together.
I'm teaching, Prue. Don't you see my Facebook posts?
Prudence just smiled.
I'm head of home economics. I'm the new Miss Jubber.
Her eyes sparkled.
I bet you never thought you'd hear those words, did you? And granted, I wasn't the best student in Miss Jubber's class, but I did pick up a few tricks here and there. And then, well, about 10 years ago, there was an opening at the school. The advert found me quite by mistake. I was thinking about early retirement, but I decided it was fate. Put in an application and, well, here I am. It's my kitchen you'll be teaching those girls in, Prue.
She lowered her voice.
I have to say, I'm actually a little anxious. You'll be seeing what skills I've taught them over the years, and most likely you'll find them wanting. But domestic science isn't like it was in our day, Prue. They might be lacking a few of the basics.
Prudence hadn't stopped smiling throughout.
Poppy Balloon, she said, as I live and breathe.
There were still a couple of girls from school that Prue had kept in touch with over the years, but the sight of Poppy brought back a million memories.
There's so much to catch up on. Not for me, Prue. I've been watching you on TV for years. Yes, all us old St. Marianne girls have followed what you've been up to with interest. That includes me, said the final voice around the table.
Prudence looked round to see yet another familiar face. This one was more heavy with lines than any other at the table. The lady herself shrunken with age, but the way she held herself, with her eyes cast fractionally down and her hands folded in her lap, immediately told Prue who this was.
Miss Downer? She ventured.
Yes,
the old lady said, her voice whispery and full of cracks. You girls did call me that over the years. It's Miss Down, Prudence.
Prudence's heart sank, even while in the corner of her eye she saw Poppy stifling a laugh. Yes. Miss Down had started at St. Marianne's as a youthful library assistant in the same year that Prudence, Poppy, and the other girls had begun their studies there. She'd been a glum young woman then, the perfect person to haunt the library stacks, and with a name like Verity Down, it was only natural that the girls should start calling her Veritable Downer. Prue had quite forgotten that it was a nickname at all. She was about to gabble an apology when Poppy burst in.
Miss Down's the longest-standing member of staff there's ever been at St. Marianne's. You fell in love with the library there, didn't you, Miss Down? You just couldn't leave.
Well, a place like St. Marianne's rather gets under the skin, said Miss Down primly. There isn't a place in the world I'd rather be. Well, there we have it, Miss Carruthers interjected,
rising again to her feet, even as Prudence sat down.
We merry few are the beating heart of St. Marianne's, Prudence, and now here you are to tantalise us across the next 2 weeks. But there's something I wanted to say first.
She gazed around the bustling restaurant floor. It was, thought Prudence, like something out of the space age plonked down on a Cornish headland.
A school has stood on the site of St. Marianne since the 17th century. And I am honoured to be the woman tasked with carrying its torch for this generation. It is a proud school with a noble tradition.
Here Poppy bowed her head and whispered to Prue, she fancies she has a touch of nobility herself. Get her talking about it, Prue. She'll soon chew your ear off. Reckon she's descended from Gwendolyn, one of the old Cornish queens. And from that, she lowered her voice further, all the way back to Brutus of Troy.
And Prudence here is one of our exemplary stars. It is my fervent hope that the next 2 weeks will not only bring our girls some vital education in the business of cookery and kitchen management, but a little inspiration as well. For who else of all St. Marianne's daughters could ever be as inspiring as
Mrs. Carruthers didn't get the chance to finish that sentence. A good thing, too, because Prudence felt a little sickly at all the praise being poured onto her. Because at that moment, a waiter, bedecked in white and gold brocade, appeared at the table, and with the most obsequious of smiles declared, Chef has been notified that we have another star of the foodie firmament in the building tonight, and he has consequently arranged for some special starters to come to the table. I've been asked to tell you how honoured he is, Mrs. Bulstrode, to be cooking for a fellow gastronome tonight. Everyone else at the table started cooing and making wide-eyed expressions in Prue's direction, so it was only right that Prudence said,
thank you, and you must pass my love to Benji as well.
Mrs. Bulstrode, he shall be delighted. Prudence wondered if that was quite true. That business with the mountain gorillas had been rather exasperating for them both, but didn't have to hide her confusion for too long. Next moment, other waiters were waltzing into place, bringing with them platters of strange charcuterie, roses crafted out of Sardinian lard, ramekins filled with mussels and steaming in sake. And for your delectation, the bluff's pièce de résistance. The final waiter had come armed with a rack of tiny phials, each capturing a constantly writhing green steam beneath their stoppers. It looked to Prudence like something out of the dungeons in those Harry Potter movies she sometimes watched with Suki's brother, her grandson George. But apparently, everybody else at the table thought this the very height of sophistication. As each phial was placed in front of its diner, the waiter proclaimed, "Draw into the lungs as one would the bouquet of a fine wine," and proceeded to illustrate this very taxing procedure by unstopping the cork of his own phial, snorting up the steamy insides, and making the kind of satisfied sound that a cat makes upon curling up to sleep.
"It's like we're stepping into a pine forest," Mrs. Carruthers began. "Heady stuff," Bernie Hogg declared.
Old Miss Down seemed to be luxuriating in hers, while Poppy had snorted it right up. As for Prudence, she was game for anything, and imbibed the steamy concoction exactly as she'd been told. It was pleasant enough, she supposed, though nothing like those Persian shisha pipes she'd tried when she was filming Prue Spice Up Your Life on her trip around the Middle East.
"Doesn't anyone remember a good old prawn cocktail?" she dared to venture. "It's dreadfully old-fashioned now, of course, but there's a part of me still hankers for prawns and Mary Rose sauce. And I rather think we've all forgotten the simple pleasures of a good old melon baller."
"Not so," came a silky baritone voice. Upon looking over her shoulder,
Prudence was met with none other than the dark, bestubbled face of Benjie Huntington Lagan himself. Benji was a tall beanpole of a man, with waves of black hair and eyebrows to match. His strong jaw and aquiline nose were as much part of his star appeal as his cookery, for Prudence had once seen a calendar devoted to sexy shots of him hunkered over his stove, and knew in that moment that the worlds of cookery and tawdry reality television had truly intertwined. There he stood, in pristine chef whites. You couldn't trust a chef whose clothes were pristine. It was practically a matter of honour. One hand on his hip and in the other, a delicate glass bowl. May I present for you, Mrs. Bulstrode? He set the concoction down, and Prudence was staggered to see three fat prawns balanced there, drizzled in a delicate pink sauce. My deconstructed prawn cocktail, Benji declared. And melon balls. Next, he placed beside the glass a single porcelain spoon, upon which was piled a pyramid of tiny globules that might easily have been mistaken for caviar, were they not luminous yellows and greens. 100 little melon balls, made with my signature gel, and each designed to burst with flavour upon your palate. When Benji beamed, Prudence was quite certain that his teeth were luminous as well. They were certainly not the same teeth he'd had the last time she saw him. This ought to tickle those taste buds, better than those crock-pot recipes you cooked up in Uganda, Prue. Bon appetit. It was then that the dinner truly began. Back at St Marianne's School for Girls, Suki was quietly convinced that her grandmother would find the domestic science classrooms something of a sacrilege. Every countertop had a KitchenAid standing in pride of place. Every refrigerator sparkled with lights, recording not just temperature, but humidity, shelf space, and estimates of the longevity of every foodstuff stored within. iPads were mounted on every wall, and every cooking station had what appeared to be a voice-activated timer unit, so that the students barely had to use their hands at all. There were at least wooden spoons in the canisters at each station, and though there wasn't a hand whisk in sight, the appearance of a good, well-used wooden spoon, ingrained with the residue of decades of dishes, might be enough to make Prue feel all right. Now that their packs were safely decanted into the refrigerators and larders, Suki supposed it would be all right to head upstairs to their rooms. Back home in Chelwood Gill, Doogie would still be up, no doubt studying for his exams, because Doogie never shied away from his studies like Suki did, and might be in need of a distraction. The hallways of St. Marianne's echoed strangely as Suki plodded up the great staircase, up to the girls' quarters at the very top. Prudence had put in a special request that she be housed in the very same rooms where she had lived as a girl, and Suki take the room next door. But when Suki got there, she couldn't really see what all the fuss was about. It would be hard to get nostalgic about a room as small and basic as this. Just a bed, a bedside cabinet, a chest of drawers, and a little writing desk in the window. Still, there was a box of chocolates on the pillow, and this was surely a better evening meal than whatever hoity-toity guff her grandmother was currently devouring up at the bluff. Before she settled down to call Doogie, would a video call be out of the question? Suki went to the window and gazed out over the grounds. Her grandmother spoke with such fondness of this school, but there seemed to Suki something inordinately sad about children packaged off to board all term long. Once upon a time, her grandmother had gazed out of this window and seen the very same sights as Suki was seeing now. Just the outbuildings, hunkering under the rain, the wilderness of the construction site that had churned up the old hockey pitch, and the last of the workmen accepting defeat and tramping off home for the night. Boarding schools. There would come a time, Suki suspected, when the very idea was tantamount to child cruelty. She was still standing there,
trying to summon up something witty and charming to ease into the coming conversation with Doogie, when there came a knock at the door. Nor was there any time to answer it, for soon the door was opening up, and two of the girls who'd rescued them on the roadside, Hetty and Sophie, were standing there with a bottle in hand.
"Ronnie Green's still not back," said the girl named Hetty,
with a dark shake of the head.
"So your camper's still beached on the hillside, I'm afraid. He must be up there now, trying to get it sorted." "Either that, or he's driven it straight off a cliff," Sophie chimed in.
Startled, Suki looked back at the scene through the window, but all she saw was the construction site, the swamp the rain was making of the works, the last lights of the workmen as they left the grounds.
"Still, while the cat's away," grinned Sophie,
and soon both she and Hetty had gambolled into the room, flopped onto Suki's bed, and extended the bottle towards her with devilish grins.
"It's only sherry. I haven't got much taste for the stuff myself, but devils can't be choosers."
"Beggars," said Suki.
"I beg your pardon?"
"It's beggars who can't be choosers."
"Yeah, them too," said Hetty. "We pinched it from the staff room just now. Well, while your grandmother and mine are off living the high life up at the bluff."
There was something in this that Suki didn't quite understand. "Your grandmother?" she queried.
"Old Mus Balloon belongs to Hetty," laughed Sophie,
opening up the bottle and taking a long, half-troubled sniff of its contents.
"She reckons she went to school with your old bird."
"And she hasn't stopped talking about it ever since it was announced," Hetty groaned. "Prudence this and Prudence that. Let me tell you about the time when Prue and I went picnicking up at Castallock Cove. Let me tell you about this boy old Prudence was sweet on." Hetty's eye roll was so dramatic, her eyes nearly vanished into her head.
"It's enough to put you to sleep.
But I bet you know what that's like if you work for your grandmother. That's got to be just as bad as being taught by one.
Here."
Hetty offered Suki the bottle. "Why should it be the old folk who have all the fun? All that posh grub up at the bluff, and they'll be back here half sozzled later. And there's us with just a few DVDs in the common room and soup in the microwave. It stands to reason. We deserve some fun." Suki recognised that tone of voice. It was the same tone that the little voice inside her often adopted. The one that told her to live for the day, to care not what tomorrow might bring. That she was only young once. That her parents were boring, stuffy old fools. And life was for living and living right now. She'd given in to that voice on many occasions in the past, but never when she was out on a job with her grandmother. This job had started out as her grandmother's way of scaring her straight, teaching her some life skills, making sure she didn't get into too much trouble. It had put a second voice in her head, a much more sombre and sober one, telling her in no uncertain terms, "Do not let your grandma down." But then again, what the girls said had been right. Her grandmother was out on the town right now, living it up with a fancy meal and, no doubt, a glass of something strong of her own.
"Just one, then," said Suki,
and scrabbled around in her bag to find some paper cups.
"One to get the week going, just to start things off on the right foot, you understand." "That," Mrs. Carruthers declared, "was delicious."
At the side of the table, Benji Huntington Lagan looked as proud as a peacock. He seemed to preen like a peacock as well, strutting up and down the table and accepting compliments from each of the diners, like a king soaking up the offerings of peasants at court. The main course, which Prudence was just finishing off, had been a seared salmon with pickled vegetables and watercress salad, and would have been perfectly lovely if only Benji hadn't insisted on serving the salmon in six different ways. In crisps and powders, cakes and batter, frozen raw and burnt to a crisp. There was talent in what he'd done, that much was true, but Prudence was quite certain the whole thing would have tasted better cooked on papillote with a nice knob of butter and a dash of fresh lemon. Even so, it was magnificent,
Prudence said as Benji's eyes lit on hers. Coming from you, Mrs. Bulstrode, that makes this evening more special than any. And now, here comes dessert.
There were few things more awkward in the culinary world than a chef loitering over you as you ate the dishes he'd just prepared. To Prudence, it had the feeling of an exam about it. And at once she was back in the examinations hall at St Marianne's, the old mathematics tutor, Mr. Scott, walking up and down the rows of students, peering at each as he came. The difference was, at least in mathematics, you weren't expected to sing your teacher's praises every time you resolved a simple equation. Waiters fanned around the table, setting down delicate china plates, upon which whole tails of lobster seemed to sit.
Lobster? Bernie Hogg trumpeted. Lobster for dessert? I've heard of some fancy things, but nothing like this.
Prudence watched as Bernie Hogg reached for his lobster, only to find his hand sink through its delicate pink shell and get lost in the creme pâtissière, raspberry preserve and fluffy pink sponge within.
By jingo, it's not lobster at all. It's ladies and gentlemen, Benji pronounced. Consider the way the meringue shell dissolves at your touch. Think, perhaps, about the way we eat with our eyes, our ears, our fingers, every last one of our senses.
He looked at Prudence again, fluffed up with pride.
This is not just dessert, of course. It is a commentary on the fragility of our senses. I bid you enjoy.
Prudence found herself compelled to join in the applause that followed Benji as he returned to the kitchens. And as she took her first bite, she had to admit that he'd done a decent job with the sponge. The meringue work was precise and impressive, and even the raspberry sauce had a wonderful piquancy to it, offsetting the sweetness in the rest of the dish. It just all seemed so unnecessary somehow. The whole thing had the taste of her very own raspberry roulade, and she could have made 20 roulades in the time it had evidently taken Benji to craft this.
A message from Chef, Mom, intoned one of the waiters, bending down to Prudence's ear.
He should very much like to see you again while you're in Cornwall,
perhaps even to take you on a tour of the Bluff's kitchens. If not tonight, then one day soon. We have a kitchen fit for the 21st century, Mrs. Bulstrode. It really is a wonder of engineering.
Prudence paused while she let a fragment of pink meringue shell dissolve on her tongue.
I should like that very much, she lied,
wondering how long she could bite her tongue for as Benji showed her all his gadgetry, pontificating on gels and smokes and how cookery was really just chemistry. Well, there'd be no chemistry, no files and dry ice and other paraphernalia back in the Bwindi impenetrable park. In lots of ways, Prudence decided, those mountain gorillas had been the truest diners of all. All they cared about was taste. On the other side of the kitchen doors, Benji Huntington-Lagan ripped off his chef's hat and dragged his cuff across his brow. At the pot wash, his sous-chef Sonny looked up and stared.
By God, that woman! Benji growled. She thinks if you cook with anything more than a wooden spoon, you're breaking an ancient taboo. If you season with much more than salt, it's an affront to a woman like that. It's no wonder she's not on the telly anymore. You've got to move with the times. You've got to embrace the new. Otherwise, we'd all be eating pottage and dumplings. I tell you what, Sonny, if mankind only ever had the imagination of people like Prudence Bulstrode, we'd never have started cooking in the first place. We'd still be eating our meat raw. It would have been too adventurous to even try putting meat on a spit. There'd be men out there, just discovered fire, and along Prue would come and say, oh, don't put a nice loin of wild pig over that. It's too scientific.
Sonny, a slight rangy boy with a mop of dirty coloured hair and as much grease on his face as in one of the pans just used to sear scallops, snorted at that. Sonny was many things. A talented pot washer, excellent at taking orders, a half-decent pastry chef, and reliable prepper.
but the thing he was very best at was bolstering his Uncle Benji's ego. Sonny knew exactly when to laugh, because he'd learnt it by rote. "Yes, chef, and fish too," he cackled. Benji stared at him severely, but Sonny just chortled on. "We'd be eating all this fish raw as well, if it was up to old Probo out there." "Well, Sonny, eating fish raw is... well, it's on our menu, Sonny, so..." There was no point going on. Sonny was lost in some merriment of his own, so Benji decided to change tack. "I've invited the old bird to look at our kitchens. That'll show her how far she's been left behind. That'll show her how times are moving on." And with that delicious thought on his lips, he turned back to the kitchen serving hatch, caught sight of Prudence through the opening, and proceeded to give her a dainty little wave. Prudence was waving back, wondering how on earth she might extricate herself from that particular appointment when dessert came to its satisfying end, and with Poppy clinging to her arm as if they were still teenage girls out on a jolly, they ventured back to the night. The rain had not yet abated, but at least the cars were waiting. One private hire to take Bernie Hogg back to his seaside manor. "I'm afraid it's tea and bed for me, Mrs. Bulstrode. My wife passed on some years ago, but I should love to entertain you one evening, if you're of a mind." A taxi cab to take Poppy and Verity back to their homes in Penzance, and the final car waiting to ferry Prudence and Mrs. Carruthers back to the school. By the way she was reeling around, giddy with the night, Prudence was only glad Mrs. Carruthers had declined to drive them herself. "We simply must catch up properly, Prudence," said Poppy, as she slipped into the taxi cab. "A proper girly catch-up, just like in the old days. And you must come with me to see poor old Miss Jubber. She's up at the Cherry Garth, the retirement home just up the coast. Not 100% compos mentis these days, I'm afraid, but I've been visiting her every month ever since I came back. She can talk the hind legs off a donkey if you catch her in the right mood. That mind of hers might have its cracks now, but it's a treasure trove of stories, all about the old days."
"And we must have a proper catch-up too," added Bernie Hogg out of his car window as his driver whisked him away.
"I think you may have found yourself an admirer, Mrs. Bulstrode," said Mrs. Carruthers, as they took again to the mountain road, winding slowly down the steep path into Castalloch Cove, the sea waves crashing somewhere beneath them. "I do hope you enjoyed your evening, Prudence. I wanted to show you that we're deadly serious about giving our girls the best education we can. It's such a responsibility. I take it very seriously indeed. And in 2 weeks' time, when it comes to our end-of-course banquet, we're going to invite all the parents, you understand. We ought to see some real development in them. I can't wait to see it." "I don't think we'll be preparing anything quite as flash as at the Bluff, Mrs. Carruthers. Girls need to know the basics if they're to have a solid foundation. That's what Miss Jubber taught me. You can't go the distance if you don't know where you're from. Using all Benji Huntington Lagan's fancy contraptions is all well and good, but if you don't know how to cook a chicken, you're going to get salmonella." "Yes, well, something a bit flash might be just the thing. Something just a bit impressive. I don't want to be serving the parents boiled eggs in 2 weeks' time. They'll want to know they've got their money's worth." Mrs. Carruthers beamed. "So will I."
Oh, thought Prudence. So that was how it was going to be. The delights of returning to St. Marianne's for the summer would be offset by a thoroughly modern head teacher, one who was absolutely enthralled to her spreadsheets, one who was absolutely determined to get exactly what she'd paid for. Prudence didn't dwell on this for very long. She simply said,
"I'll have those girls in good order, Mrs. Carruthers. You can count on it."
Then she turned to the window and watched the night whooshing past. And it was only because she was fixed on this particular window, attempting to ignore Mrs. Carruthers nodding her head as she tried to fight sleep, that Prudence didn't see the construction works on the old hockey pitch up close.
It was only because she was gazing in the opposite direction that she didn't spot, through the rain lashing down, the place where the downpour had washed a mound of earth clean away, revealing a skeletal hand, still wearing a tarnished gold wristwatch, reaching up out of its unmarked grave, as if desperate to take the hand of another, as if desperate to be hauled back into the light, as if desperate to be found. Chapter 2. Suki woke to a pounding head, a sticky body, and a sour taste at the back of her throat. It didn't matter at all that, sometime in the night, the rains had abated, and beautiful, buttery summer sunshine now poured in through the windows. It didn't matter at all that the birds were singing on the gutters just above her bedroom, nor that her phone had registered half a dozen messages from Doogie during the night. On any other morning, these things might have made her feel fit to face the day, but right now, all that she could think about was the taste of that sherry, the whooping of the girls, and the fact that there was simply no way on earth that she'd be able to hide this from her grandmother. Prudence knew everything. She'd known about it when Suki used tangerine instead of mandarin in the upside-down pudding on their last job. She'd known about it when Suki basted a pork loin in vegan margarine instead of butter. She'd even known about it when Suki hadn't tied her hair back properly when making the desserts for the Chelwood Gill Parish Council. Although, to be fair, anyone would have noticed a thick black hair curling out of their egg custard. Prudence sniffed out everything, and it wouldn't take more than 1 second to sniff out the sourness on Suki's breath. Time was already against her. Her iPhone showed it was creeping past 9:30 a.m, and that meant that the girls would soon be congregating for their first lesson in the domestic science classroom. Suki ought to have been there, helping her grandmother with the morning prep, and instead, she was lurching across the room, dropping her head at the sink in the corner and swilling her mouth out straight from the tap. There was only one thing for this, a little concoction her old friend Numbers had given her. For Numbers, despite being a teetotaler, seemed to have the recipe for everything. Soon she was filling a paper cup with his patented mixture of toothpaste, a healthy glug of mouthwash, and just a few drops of the supermarket own brand perfume her mother had bought her last Christmas, then stirring it up with the shaft of her toothbrush. A cocktail like this was heady enough to banish even the worst of morning after smells. Suki threw her head back and began to gargle it around the back of her throat. Then, when the acidic tang of the mouthwash, with just its dash of perfume, like Tabasco added to tomato juice to give it a kick, was too much, she bowed suddenly forward and spat it back out. When she opened her eyes and looked in the mirror, she was furious to see how red and puffy her eyes had become. There wasn't a recipe to get rid of that, and her grandmother absolutely hated it when she wore sunglasses inside. But that wasn't the only thing that caught her attention, for reflected in the mirror, she could see...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.